On the East Coast, we are running a couple minutes behind because of some minor technical difficulties. And this is news that you can use from YAA with your hosts, Zach and Ray. Sorry we're late, folks.
Yeah, we were going to have a special guest, Shari, from the Car Help Center and or the Car Center. I'm super bummed. I showed up late for the rehearsal, and my apologies, gang. And we led with "This country has run out of cars," and the reason we did that is because Shari's from the great country of
Canada,
and they've run out of cars, man. I thought it was a great clickbait title, and we were going to have a conversation around it, but unfortunately, we cannot. Instead, Dad, why don't we kick things off? We'll continue beating the drum over on the FTC side of things. And Shari is with us below the screen. So, Shari, if you end up figuring out the headphone situation, just wave your hand. I'll try and add you in, and we can give it a shot. More than happy to try it. That's how we do things here. But let's kick things off, Dad, with the FTC. You submitted your comment just yesterday. Can you remind everyone at home what the FTC is doing and why it is important right now that we all submit comments on behalf of ourselves and consumers to try and get these rules approved?
The FTC has put together some proposals for a little more clarity when it comes to dealer price advertising, dealer add-ons, clarity in F&I products, rules against selling things that will add absolutely no value. And it's once they do this, they open up a 60-day window for public comment. Now, NADA, the North American Dealers Association, sent a 4-page letter expressing why they felt that, you know, the status quo is just fine. This is just going to cost us money, and ultimately it's going to cost the consumers more money because, I don't know, we'd have to tell the truth. And so I think it was on today's Wednesday. So on Monday, I submitted a comment expressing my full support for these rules and regulations that they're proposing. And at that time, there were only like, I don't know, 18 or 20 comments. I believe that number is now in the 90s. And a number of them, well, mentioned us, because we are trying to spearhead getting consumers all across this land to write their comments to or share their comments with the FTC in regards to why, as a consumer, you feel it would be necessary for dealers to act, I don't know, in a fair and honest manner and be held accountable to that.
Let's address one of these first questions that's come here through the chat. Andrew says, even if it passed, will bad dealers learn? Will FTC enforce the rules? I think that's a really great question, because that's part of what NADA actually said in their response was, hey, you know, these rules already exist. You just don't enforce them. So why are you adding even more rules? I think that's a really fair point.
It is a fair point. And, you know, in a lot of cases, rules are in existence. It's just that there's always been selective enforcement or no enforcement. The worst part is that everybody involved, whether it be state's attorney general, whether it be commissioners at the FTC, whether it be Congress people, whoever it may be, everybody has bought a car in their lifetime. Okay. And they know what it's like. It's not like they don't know that this is going on. It's just they haven't really enforce the rules and regulations that are on the books. This would enhance some of the regulations that are on the books. But yes, you're absolutely right. If there's no enforcement, then it really doesn't matter. And the hope would be that there would be some enforcement this time. And that perhaps if there's fines moving forward, those fines could be going to help hire more auditors to go out and audit dealerships, websites, and everything else to make sure that dealers are actually doing what they're supposed to be doing.
I think it has to come down to, Dad, the licenses that dealers hold. Like, for example, at joinya.com, we now sell auto insurance. You know the process we had to go through to become an insurance agent? We had to get licensed. I got licensed in the state of Maryland. Then you get a corporate license in the state of Maryland. Then you get all licenses in all 50 states and DC. Like, these dealerships, that they go through a process of getting approved and licensed. What if there were impacts on their license status when they take advantage of consumers? What if the FTC could do things like that, ultimately forcing them to really treat people fairly? Because they get out of it every single time, even with Napleton debt. $10 million fine. Bit of a drop in the bucket. We talked about Carvana and Vroom the other day. Vroom got an $87,000 fine from the state of Florida. Who cares? That's a drop in the bucket for them.
Yeah, it wasn't like Napleton admitted any fault. They just paid a $10 million fine. I mean, you know, if you're not guilty, why would you pay a $10 million fine? But, you know, we let corporations off the hook all the time. Yes, if there was some way for licenses to be suspended, for franchises to be taken away, put some real teeth into it. But my honest to God belief is that dealers, the good dealers across this country, should be for it, should be screaming to the mountaintop that they want these rules and regulations to be enforced, because they would want to force the bad dealers out of business. That would benefit the good dealers. It's everybody likes to say, well, a few rotten apples spoil the whole thing.
Did you read my post today, Dad? Did you read my post?
What did you post and where?
I use that line, but okay. Yeah, keep going.
Okay. I did not read your post today, but we all know that. But it's more than a few rotten apples in this case. I'm not going to say it's the vast majority, but it more than likely it's the vast majority. The good dealers are in the minority in this situation. And so the good dealers, you would think, would want to embrace this, would say to the National Automobile Dealers Association, we need to embrace this. We need to be the ones that are policing the bad dealers, pointing them out to the FTC, pointing them out to state's attorney general or consumer affairs divisions, so that they can be held accountable and we can get them out of business and we can just move into the 21st century and do business in a more customer-centric manner.
Pops, I want to just acknowledge again, for those of you just joining, this country has run out of cars. We were going to have a guest today. Car Help Center, Sherry from Car Help Center, was going to join us. Unfortunately, technical difficulty. Sherry's up in Canada. So yeah. Truly some of my best work, I think, from a title perspective. We'll have to get him back next week or hopefully sometime soon. Now, I do want to pull up that. We wrote a bit of a response here to the NADA's letter that they sent into to the FTC. So if you go to the joinyaa.com website, go under resources, then blog, Car Dealers versus Consumers, Make Your Voice Heard. I took some time. I actually wrote this up just yesterday, Dad, and posted it here on our website. And here it is. There's a reason the annual trustworthiness of profession poll from Gallup ranks car salespeople at the bottom. It's not because every salesperson is bad. It's because a few bad apples ruin the bunch. Over the years, I have heard countless stories from our community of these aforementioned practices. Still, powerful dealer lobbies are combating the FTC proposal, and it's become clear that they're determined to defeat the proposal at all costs. I encourage everyone to take a peek at our response. This is what I'll be submitting as a comment to the FTC, really endorsing their proposal. I think it's an awesome opportunity for us to stand up as a unified group and really flex our muscles. And quite frankly, Dad, if I can, to Leon's point, if there are thousands of comments, then maybe they'll listen. And I think that's why. More than we even hawk our extended warranty, we're going to be hawking this, man. This is every single day we're going to be talking about leaving comments to the FTC. It's that important.
Well, I believe there's, including today, there's 54 days left for the comment period. And I know that NADA is saying that the information that FTC is using is flawed, and this is flawed, and that's all they have to do is go to our YouTube channel and read the damn comments from average people every day about how they're treated when they go to buy cars, and all the shenanigans and fraudulent activity that occurs at dealerships. It's it's really a pretty simple thing. I mean, they don't need public comment. They could go on forums all over the internet and find all the information they need as to why these rules and proposals should be enacted. But there is a 60-day window for comment. Normally, most people aren't going to know about this, so there'll be a limited number of comments. Naturally, the NADA had a huge comment. There'll be other dealer associations and groups that'll comment. It is incumbent upon the consumers in this country to make their voices known, okay? To take 5 or 10 minutes out of their day and send a comment as to why they want to support some type of regulation that will ultimately protect you as the consumer.
Can we take a moment, Dad, to acknowledge an example of a settlement that recently happened that we would be actually trying to help get more enforcements against things like this? This literally just came out this morning in Automotive News, Dad. Let me scroll up to the top. NYC says two Brooklyn dealerships, quote, ripped off customers will pay $800,000 in settlements. Brooklyn Mitsubishi, and Brooklyn Volkswagen were accused of several deceptive business practices in New York. Shall we give it a quick peruse, Pops?
The general manager of that store, I'm not going to mention his name, but he has a huge social media presence. That's all I'll say. You don't pay an $800,000 fine if you haven't done something wrong. You just don't.
Let's walk through what happened here, Pops.
Okay.
Brooklyn Mitsubishi and Brooklyn Volkswagen have agreed to pay more than $800,000 in combined penalties and restitution. We love to see restitution. That's money going back to people's pockets. And admit violations to end a case brought by a New York consumer agency. The June 28th settlement also saw the city temporarily suspend two Brooklyn Mitsubishi licenses from July 3rd to July 9th. Yeah, that's 6 days of no licenses.
That might be 30, 40 car deals. It could be.
Maybe. Yeah. Brooklyn Mitsubishi and its used vehicle business were tied to the bulk of the 13 administrative law counts alleged by the New York City Department of Consumer and Worker Protection, including more than 7,000 instances of deceptive trade practices encompassed within one count. The accused parties, which included the dealership's parent companies and management, must collectively pay a $500,000 penalty and $300,000 worth of restitution to consumers. The city said it will keep any unspent restitution money as a civil penalty. We are helping deliver more than $300,000 back to the pockets of New York City consumers who were ripped off by Brooklyn Mitsubishi and Brooklyn Volkswagen and are stopping their unlawful behavior dead in their tracks, the city's mayor said on July 15th. About the case, Dad. Brooklyn Mitsubishi and Brooklyn Volkswagen owners. I can't read. I apologize.
Shalambos. Yeah.
Thank you. And general manager Rudy Tremino joined dealership parent companies King's Auto Show and King's Auto Show 2 Incorporated and Grand Auto Group in pleading guilty to the violations alleged in the June 23rd petition. Some of the 13 counts included allegations involving one of the two facilities, while some implicated both locations. Let's get to the meat of it. The consumer department brought accusations of selling used vehicles for more than the price advertised.
That never happens.
Deceptive trade practices, selling recalled used vehicles without providing NHTSA information, submitting false, misleading, and deceptive credit applications and contracts to the finance company, failing to provide Truth in Lending Act disclosures and financing disclosure forms, failing to communicate the precise terms a finance company can charge. We've never heard of that.
Yeah.
Conditional sales contracts on used vehicles, failing to provide complete and truthful information on license applications, failing to report a new business name, failing to report a change in address, failing to respond to subpoenas and appear for hearing, failing to maintain records for 6 years and operating a used vehicle dealership without a license.
You know what they're really good at? Failing. Okay.
The June 28th settlement came less than a week after the FTC's proposed new nationwide rules meant to in part combat bait and switch advertising. The agency has proposed requiring dealerships that advertise vehicles to show a definitive price, excluding taxes and any other government charges, at which they would sell that vehicle to anyone. The city highlighted misleading advertising in its July 15th news release and featured a victim of the practice, consumer Carini Oliviero. Oliviero saw a 2017 Jeep four-wheel drive Grand Cherokee advertised by Brooklyn Mitsubishi on Car Gurus for $27,994 and sought to buy the vehicle at that price, putting $10,000 down in June 2018, according to the agency. The dealership rushed her through documents and ultimately charged her $36,585 for the Grand Cherokee, the city alleged. When Oliviero complained, she was told she didn't qualify for that sale price because of her credit. Pops, I'm going to stop reading this article, but it is a truly perfect example of what's going on in the industry and why the FTC is trying to be more aggressive here.
It is. And at least in this particular case, they admitted guilt. They pled guilty. Now, having said that, it's probably a misdemeanor of some kind and not a felony. If it was a felony, then Mitsubishi and Volkswagen could actually terminate their franchise agreements. But it is the prime example of what it is that the FTC is trying to combat. And this goes on every day in this country at any number of dealerships. And I said it in my comments, these are business decisions that are made by the dealer principal or the management team of dealerships. When we advertise our price, should it include the destination and handling charges that would normally show up on the MSRP? Or should we just, in the small print, say does not include destination and handling charges? These are business decisions, and the businesses are deciding that they would rather utilize deceptive practices in order to reel people in, because they're afraid that if they advertise the real prices, that people won't shop there because they know there's other dealers that are advertising misleading prices. And that's why you need the proposals and you need to enforce them so that there is clarity in what the price of a vehicle is. And that price isn't based on whether or not credit-wise you have that credit score. It doesn't matter. That's the selling price, okay? The reason it's called a selling price is because allegedly that's what you'll sell it for. It's not the selling price based on your credit score. It's not the selling price based on whether or not we like you. It's the damn selling price. And that should be listed clearly and plainly for anyone to see and for anyone to buy it, regardless of whether you finance the vehicle, pay cash for the vehicle, trade cryptocurrency for the vehicle. It's the selling price, and the selling price should be plain and clear.
I love giving you the stage like that, Dad. That's awesome. Okay. Well, we'll get off of our high horse about the FTC for today, but tune in tomorrow for your next 15-minute dose of why you need to leave comments on the FTC's proposal here.
God.
All right, Dad, I want to pull up chat messages. Igor is overseas doing some intel for the YAA community. We'll be meeting with the VW Group, Porsche, Audi, Skoda, Mercedes, BMW tomorrow, and then touring their factories on Friday in Germany. Also, we'll be going to the Brabus factory on Saturday. I have news, all caps, news to bring, especially on EVs. I got major news to bring back about the future of EVs. Little teaser, affordable EVs are coming. Do you believe it, Dad? Do you believe it?
No. But I believe the manufacturers are all going to say that the affordable EVs are coming until they get here and they're no longer affordable. Whether they won't be affordable because there won't be enough of them and the dealers will be able to jack the prices way up, or the cost of producing them will have gone up from the time they said that they were going to be affordable to the time they actually get here, and they have to adjust their MSRP so that they're no longer affordable. As somebody once said, I'll believe it when I see it.
Pops, we've got a great point here from Core Guy, and then I actually want to turn our attention to Hyundai Kia earnings. They come out tomorrow, and we have a preview of that. One of the reasons why dealerships put misleading prices online and on their site is because of search algorithms. If their prices aren't even unrealistically low, their ads don't even show up. This is why. You're 100% right, Korga. It is very much a race to the bottom when it comes to buying a car. But this is 100% why. When you go on our website, I've had so many people ask me, why do you guys show two prices when you search for a car? Okay, so I'm going to the homepage. Pops, name a car.
A Mitsubishi, whatever the hell they make. I don't know.
An Eclipse. We're searching for a Mitsubishi Eclipse.
Really? They haven't made those in years.
Why are there two prices here and one of the prices is higher than the other?
Well, that's because the advertised price or the asking price and the other is the out the door price, assuming that we have the taxes, tags, registration, and dock fees correct. That would be the total. But the reality is that you probably can't go in and buy it for the $79.90 to begin with.
But that's part of my vision, Dad, is as a community, can we come together and can we actually surface, hey, actually at, let's see what dealership this is, actually at Toyota of Warren, we know that they typically, you know, other YAA members have seen that they add X percent or $1,500 in crap. Then we might be able to show a third price here, advertised price, real projected price based on community and out the door price with the real price. But this, you're never going to see this on Car Gurus. You want to know why? Because Car Gurus makes money when they generate leads. How do you generate leads? By putting unattainable prices. How do you get people to stop putting unattainable prices? You fine them or make it illegal to do this stuff. It already is illegal. Why does it exist like this?
Well, first of all, car dealers charges the dealership. Or
car gurus, yeah.
Charges yeah, the dealership course. To advertise. That's how Car Gurus makes money. If you look at our listings, we don't have any advertisers. Nobody pays to have their vehicles listed. I think the technological term is we scrape their websites every night. I don't know what we use to scrape them with, but we scrape their websites every night to gather up the information of what they're advertising on their website, and then we include it in the car listing. They're not paying us for that. Hell, some of them, as you know, have suggested to you that you should cease and desist showing our cars on your website like that. Well, you know, they advertise it. They put it on there. It becomes public information at that point. We're not showing anything that they haven't already advertised. We're not changing it. We're just sharing it. We're sharing what they put out there.
100%, Dad. All right. Do you want to? You've got two options here, Pops. One is we can go down the route and we can look at Hyundai Kia and we can start to talk a little bit about what's happening there in terms of their earnings and what we expect to see. Or I've got a great, really, you got to be kidding me. What do you think?
You know, you it's your show, buddy. I'm just here to be the pretty face.
All right. We're going to do the really, you got to be kidding me. Give me one second.
Yeah. Really? You gotta be kidding me.
All right, let me share my screen with you, Pops. This literally blows my mind. It is the second time in as many days that we've seen this. We've got someone buying a 2022 Subaru Crosstrek. They're trading in another vehicle. Now, let's focus our attention over here on the right. Market value selling price of that Subaru is this. They're adding a $3,000 that. They're adding a this. They're adding some discounts, which is nice. So they've got the Costco family plan.
Yes, so you get $449 off of that $29.95 family plan. I didn't know that I wanted to be part of their family. I can't wait for them to invite me to Thanksgiving dinner.
So we've got the family plan savings. We've got the Costco savings. Then we have a $3,762 beat our competitor discount, Pops. That is after the $3,000 worth of add-on they added. Like, what are you doing here? I don't get it.
You know, what they're doing is they're playing with numbers. That's what they're doing. And they, you know, if you put enough numbers up there, it becomes confusing as hell. Okay. And so that's what they're doing. They're trying to baffle you with BS. Okay. It's called, It's actually called the term for it in the industry when you do it. It's called information overload. You provide the consumer with way too much information so that they really can't make heads or tails of whatever it is that you're doing. You get that $3,760 off, you know, after we charge you an $899 dock fee and a $3,000 family plan fee. I mean, it's just all BS.
Pops, hang tight. I actually want to switch and actually do a positive. I want to talk about something positive, but it's a text message that someone sent me, and I need to send it to myself really quick so I can pull it up on the screen. Can you give me your best, like, 30 seconds?
Well, I will tell you, I received an email from a customer earlier.
A YAA member?
A YAA member, not a customer, a YAA member, and he's ordering a Ford pickup truck, and he was asking me, you know, am I getting a good deal? Meanwhile, Marvin, your inbox is full, so you couldn't get my return email that I sent to you. So hopefully you're watching this damn show. So he's ordering a truck, okay? And it had an A Protect package. I don't know what the hell that is for $7.95. Nano Shield for $5.99, paintless dent repair for $4.95, and paint and interior protection for $4.95. Now, I said to him, I said, are these things that you wanted? Because if they're not, then you need to get them to take them off the buyer's order. And they can't tell you that they were installed at the factory because they're not. And they haven't been put on the car yet because it hasn't arrived. So what you need to tell them to do is, when they write up the RO for the PDI, and the RO stands for repair order, and PDI stands for pre-delivery inspection, that you want nothing added to it. They could just write on the RO, PDI only, and that way they won't have to install the items you might not have wanted. And by the way, clear out your inbox so you can get other messages in it.
Again, if you want help as you're navigating car buying, obviously be a part of the YouTube channel here. Go to the community forum, email us, whatever. This is what we do day in, day out. Igor, I can get in trouble for this, but I'll share. Chips are available. Manufacturers are slowing production on purpose. It's more profitable with less overhead. I'd buy aspects of that. I really would. I trust Absolutely. Igor, and also they make a lot of money right now, so it makes a lot of sense.
Can we celebrate a win? Yeah, absolutely.
Can we celebrate a win?
Yeah.
All right, Dad. My dear friend Elizabeth, I used to work with her. Now we're friends. Yes. I live in her apartment now, but she moved out. Anyway, long story.
Well, you live in what used to be her apartment.
To be her apartment. Yeah.
Yeah.
She got her car got totaled.
About
3 weeks ago, and so we're friends. She knows about YAA. She became a member. Look at these text messages I got yesterday, Dad. Just talk down an $8,000 market adjustment to zero.
That's pretty good.
And then Justice, shout out to you because I know you're here on the chat. Yeah. I sent her this little like heart emoji thing because I was so excited. She said, Justice confirmed they were overcharging for everything. Glad he was there to be a resource for you. Was he helpful? She said, he's fantastic. How'd you feel going through the process? She said, oh, absolutely. I would have just paid full price before the market with the market fee. He saved me at least $8,000, already wrote a review. So
that's a nice win. Yeah,
that's a huge win. $8,000 is not trivial. So a perfect example of how you can come in here and you can actually get educated. And it goes to Core Guy's point. Let me scroll back up and let me pull this up. Where is it? Right here. Guys, the dealership model is designed to extract the most amount of profit from the buyer. The only way to counter this is to become more informed and confident with your research and your situation. You do that, Pops, you end up being like Elizabeth and saving you some money. And don't worry about those comments, Dad. No one can see them because it's on Twitch, and we're not on Twitch, so don't worry about that.
Okay, cool. I'm not worried
about it. There's two people on Twitch. We've got a hater on Twitch, but that's okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I wish the hater on Twitch would tell us who he really is and be man enough or woman enough.
It's not that because literally.
But if I may, there's people out there that keep saying that You can't save money. Dealers won't negotiate the additional dealer markup. Here's the thing about additional dealer markup. That's asking for it. It's like anything else. You can either accept it, reject it, or amend it. Okay. You can either say, okay, I'll pay that $8,000. You could say, I wouldn't pay that $8,000, or you can amend it. I might be willing to pay $2,000 of the $8,000. Let's talk about it. It's not that you have to accept it just because the dealer's asking for it. They're hoping you will accept it, but you don't have to. And if you do things well, you can save some of that money.
Pops, Igor here saying this could be my last invite to Geneva, so I figured I'll spill the beans and share everything. I know you guys all deserve the truth. Thank you for that, Igor.
Yes.
Thank you, everyone, for being here with us today. Again, we had technical difficulties. That's why we started late, so sorry about that. We are going to try and get Sherry back on the show, so stay tuned. We have another guest lined up for next week as well, so we're trying to get more people onto the show sooner rather than later. Pops, I'll see you back here tomorrow. We'll probably beat the same drum for a little while about the FTC and then talk about the other news stories. We're going to have earnings. Earnings season is right around the corner. Yes. Hyundai Kia earnings are out tomorrow. We expect to start to see the bad sales numbers. And unfortunately, we don't see, I mean, Igor's saying there's chips available, but we're not seeing manufacturers start to put them into cars and things like
that's the new car supply situation, still tricky.
Yep. Yeah.
I think I'll see you back here around too, because I believe we'll be filming a video with Lucky Lopez today. So that'll be something else that will be dropping on the YAA channel at some point. So looking forward to it.
Indeed, Pops. All right. I will catch you later. Thank you guys for being here. Enjoy the afternoon, Dad, and I'll see you in about 90 minutes.
Yep. Thank you, everybody. We'll see you again tomorrow with more news that you can use at noon Eastern, 9 Pacific.